today on X-Play. Since the beginning of time, the staff of X-Play has had but one secret desire: to get a helper monkey. Dreams really do come true. It's monkey time. Think of no greater honor than to introduce Adam Sessler, Morgan Webb, and a monkey.
Hello and welcome to X-Play. We totally have a monkey. This one, not Sessler.
Oh, ha ha! Yeah, since the dawn of man, we here at the show desperately wanted a monkey. Why? Because monkeys are awesome. They get to swing from trees and throw their own poop with impunity. Now see, if I do that, I get arrested.
Hi, also, buddy. This monkey has an actual acting resume, which means he's far more skilled than either Sessler or me. This monkey has worked with Academy Award winner Dustin Hoffman. He's worked with Harvey Keitel. Yeah, Morgan Freeman, David Schwimmer. I, on the other hand, once interviewed a man dressed as a morbidly obese Jedi.
So, if anything, we hope today to bring you the joy and wonder of seeing an adorable monkey on your television, while Morgan and I pick up some valuable acting tips.
This is method acting, people. Look, the monkey. The monkey just is.
Just is. He's teaching me right now. Now, of course, getting a monkey wasn't only about improving the quality of our artistic process.
It was also about getting a little more help around the X-Play office. And you know what? This monkey puts the helper back into helper monkey.
He also puts the monkey back into helper monkey as well. Hey, buddy.
Monkeys are very helpful. It's even in their name, Helper Monkey. We're so glad Spencer is finally here to help us with all of our office tasks, being that we hate doing things for ourselves, and our massive celebrity is surprisingly ineffective in getting people to pander to our every whim. I mean, who do we have to be to live out our lives as insufferable leeches on the public good? Anyway, Spencer started right away. He helped us copy the scripts.
Spencer, yeah, Morgan's fingers are needed for playing video games. Can you say huddled masses yearning to make copies?
Then we set him to work on a Vietnam game no one else wanted to play. We figured the jungle habitat would remind him of home, and he would probably enjoy the simulated slaughter of his human overlords. Turns out, the soothing forest cover and the bloody massacre didn't compensate for the crappy camera angles, glitchy controls, and offensive simplification of a complicated international conflict. So he wrote a scathing review to that effect. He even included the words teabag, bling, and McNamara. We're very proud. He's so good at many of our other day-to-day tasks as well. For example, comforting Adam in his many moments of crisis.
So, I don't know. I get a feeling a lot of times the people just don't want me around. No one, but when they look at me, they look really mean. I don't know.
People just don't point guns at me. Things could be a little bit better, but I don't really have a pillow right now because someone burned it.
Spencer is particularly good at making fun of the interns. We all know that they don't make fun of themselves, and heckling them into submission can sometimes be a full-time job. Even demonstrates the embarrassing games in our show for free, just like the rest of our minions. I mean, interns. Dance, monkey, dance. Love you, Spencer. We hope you never leave us.
Look, he loves Adam.
That's a first.
For Adam. But please don't poop on me.
I bet he could feed you the poison dates like in Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Just regular dates have a pretty poisonous effect on me, you know. Just don't bite me. Nope.
The monkey did such an amazing job around the office, so we thought we'd let him try something else.
And since we get a ton of viewer mail saying, "You guys are awful," a monkey could have done a better review of that game. We thought the little guy would take a crack at doing our job for us. So here are some reviews done by our very own X-Play monkey. Don't give me a monkey virus.
Hey kids, it's Monkey See, Monkey Critically Evaluate. We decided to have Spencer edify ourselves on games that he would be most qualified to render his opinion on. Games that feature his brethren from wherever it is monkeys come from. Clint Eastwood, I think. So we started him off on the easy stuff, Black and White. Look, he's being tickled. Coochie, coochie, coo. Whoa, Spence, yeah. True, he's a little emaciated. Okay, he could bed with Laura Flynn Boyle and there's still room for William Taft, but we're keeping him happy. Moving on. Time for social issue games. Whiplash, the pay it forward of the video game world. Of course, it's tough to identify with the Nick Nolte equivalent of the ferret world, but once Spencer saw this game's anti-animal testing attitude through the abuse of animals, he was down with the cause. Well, with simian empowerment in mind, we move over to the positive portrayals of primates, in such classics as Primal Rage. Now, while we found the game visceral back when it was available, we never identified with the sense of threat when confronted with a bipedal dinosaur. But in short time, our newest reviewer who poops himself with impunity was feeling the intensity and couldn't contain his desire to be part of the action on screen. He really liked. He seemed really into it. He clearly was into the monkey on anything else action, and not wanting to create tension with our newest diaper-wearing employee, we indulged him with War of the Monsters. Wow, he sure loves the way that apes beat up lizards and stuff. Spencer? Okay, moving on. Nothing's better than the colorful whimsy of a boy using too much mousse and a stun baton. Look, little monkey's wearing funny hats with lights. It's like Elton John during the cocaine years. Look, he's beating, capturing. Okay, moving on. Monkey ball, look, they're so cute. Well, yeah, they're trapped in, but they're survivors. Oh boy. No, Spencer, these games are aberrations. We'll visit this later, Spencer. I think someone threw his mom.
Well, so far, I give this episode 3 plunk poos out of 5.
And it's only gonna get better. Why? Hello, we have Monkey. Hi, little friend.
X-Play presents Rejected X-Play Helper Monkeys.
We had to audition several monkeys before we found the fabulous Spencer. We wish we could have kept them all, but in the end, there can be only one true helper monkey.
Up next, in a world full of monkeys, only one ape is king. Oh, and there's also Donkey Kong.
G4 is like a clan of plasma pixies who want nothing more than to satisfy your every entertainment indulgence. They will introduce you to the TV shows you need to know about, fawn over your gadget lust, scour the web for the craziest videos, and plug your brain into the latest comics, game systems, and films. They're good like that. Anyhow, G4 is exactly like that. Kinda.
So, where do you think this guy should move?
I'd say this way. And let's make sure that sound effect we used in the last level fits in here too.
This one?
Yeah.
You know, I'm so glad I got into game design. It's cool to be able to create the kind of games that we play.
I know what you mean. And the training at Collins College takes less time than most people might think.
Can you believe we get paid to do this?
For a complimentary DVD, call 888-823-0999. Operators are standing by. That's 888-823-0999. Call now.
Once again, your co-hosts, a man, a woman, and a monkey.
If you're just joining us, this is a big day in X-Play history. We finally got a helper monkey. Isn't he cute?
Yes, you know, in the long tradition of shows trying to improve their ratings by adding a small child or adorable animal to the cast, we have legally acquired a monkey.
Because no one in their right mind would let a small child appear on the show.
And I have to say, the addition of a monkey to X-Play has had more than cosmetic changes. Now that we have three co-hosts here, well, one of whom, if the film outbreak is believed, may be carrying a lethal virus, well, that's really made a sense of urgency and excitement right here on the set.
Will the monkey attack one of us?
Will the monkey poop on one of us?
Will the monkey give the studio crew Ebola?
It's never been more dynamic than this. And if you think the monkey's impact on air is incredible, well, you should see the kind of things he's doing off camera.
For example, he urged us to take a look at famous monkeys in video game history. And that's why we're bringing you a look at the most famous polygonal monkey of all, Donkey Kong.
It was such a simple idea. Monkey steals girl. Monkey throws barrels. Monkey operates a small-time elevator mill. Monkey creates a revolutionary way to make pies. But this isn't about the monkey. It's about Mario. Yes, Mario, one of the greatest revolutionary characters in the world of video games. What's that, Spencer? Mario's a what? Spencer, who taught you that word? When did you meet Diane Mazzotta? Really? What? A pizza-eating son of a... Spencer! Fine, Spencer, fine. No more Mario. It's about Donkey Kong. El Donquito Kongito. One of the greatest revolutionary characters in the world of video games. Most people believe Donkey Kong to be the aggressor in the Donkey Kong-Mario relationship. But was he? We soon learned that wasn't the case. This time, Kong was the victim. And he played the role perfectly, bringing in his recently adopted Ethiopian son to help in the cause. DK was adopting underprivileged children way before Mr. and Mrs. Smith made it trendy. However, Kongi always had trouble holding on to his money. Taking this job in Donkey Kong 3 didn't help his street cred. Can he get any more demeaning? But like the true scholar he is, the Donkey Donk got all dangerous minds on us with Donkey Kong Jr. Math. I know what you're saying. Yes, this is the same plot of A Beautiful Mind. Ron Howard's a hack, and I never liked Apollo 13. After that, DK got drafted and went to country, knee-deep in the fertilizer. That war, that damn war. I love the smell of monkey feces in the morning. I guess we'll never understand what DK went through in country. We weren't there. But destiny changed for our scrappy simian. Konger went all 64 on us with Donkey Kong 64, a game so big they named it Donkey Kong 64. It was Kongi's Island Paradise, and we all just lived in it. And we all just lived with this.
This crazy Kong just thinks it's June.
Sadly, after taking a bath in Crash Bandicoot's ill-conceived pyramid scheme, DK took any booking he could get and appeared wherever a check could be cashed, immediately. Seeing the Konger shilling with lesser characters in lesser games made our hearts melt with sadness, but DK showed a regal presence and stayed above the fray. Or at least he tried to. Now, don't feel bad for Kongi. All this extra cash allowed him to really explore his true passion, music-based games. Kick up the jams, DK. Kick up the jams. This is just a smidgen of the influence Donkey Kong has had on our lives. What kind of world would it be without the Kongsta? We think it would go something like this. Boring. I'm out. Thanks for keeping it real, DK. Thanks for keeping it real.
That was a good segment idea, Monkey. I really learned something today.
Hey, Morgan, aren't you going to try to pay attention to me, you know, because I'm one of your co-hosts, too.
But the monkey is so little, and he's so cute, and everybody loves him. The camera loves him. Hey, come here, have a look,
me.
Have a look,
please. Me, monkey, good. You can pay attention to me, too. I'm on the show. Look, I me.
Hey.
Me.
Oh, you are a good monkey.
I wish I had a tail.
Yeah.
X-Play presents our favorite monkey swear words.
Any swear word is funnier when preceded by the word monkey, like monkey f***. monkey p***s, and of course, monkey
coming up, more monkey. Do you really need anything else?
Code Green, I think I've lost him.
Hey, haven't I seen you before?
You sure have. Look out!
Whoa! My car! It's too late to report my claim now.
Don't you have Esurance?
I do.
At Esurance, you can report your claim 24/7, online or on the phone. Always fast and friendly. You'll be back on the road in no time. Duty calls. If you're on the go, you've got to have Esurance.
Save on 24/7 claim service at Esurance.com.
An evolutionary chart come to life. It's Adam Sessler, Morgan Webb, and this monkey.
Wait, do I go before or after the monkey on the evolutionary ladder?
Welcome back to X-Play. We have a helper monkey.
He's younger than us. Oh, he's cuter than us. Mm-hmm. He's better groomed than us, right there. And he can get away with throwing his own excrement. So my job has never been more imperiled.
Yes, after email telling us that even a monkey could do a better job than us, we decided to hire one and see for ourselves. And so far, he's doing pretty well.
Yeah, we get it, buddy. We know you're adorable.
Of course, we've noticed that not only is the monkey doing well on camera, he's also doing a little too well behind the scenes.
See, look, he's being cute for the camera. Stop encouraging him.
Yes, we made a video of it, which is really exceptionally convenient.
Oh, yes, it is.
What happens when a helper monkey gets too helpful? At what point does simple assistance cross the line to become annoyance or even oppression? Having a helper monkey was great at first. Since Spencer arrived, we've finally been able to give the interns the treatment they deserve. But then, he began to show off his intelligence in unsettling ways.
Oh, checkmate! But you're a, checkmate, sure thing, yeah. Well, guess you're the smart one here at the table. All right, one more. All right, fine, checkmate, yeah, okay. You have a tail, okay. I just have fingers and a brain.
Spencer then turned his considerable intellect towards the betterment of his fellow X-Play cast members. Through a simple course of negative reinforcement, he quickly cured Link of his drinking problem.
I'm all clean and sober. My life has no meaning. Zelda. Zelda?
Next, he develops an ingenious microchip implant to stop Ratty's foul language.
Suck it. Ah! Oh, you be. Ah! Oh, kill me. Kill me now. Ah!
And hey, who wouldn't want a super intelligent capuchin around the office? I mean, what could go wrong?
We found out when we gave him access to our secret X-Play lab.
Aw, monkey in a lab coat. How cute.
Yeah, cute like a fox.
In mere hours, Spencer had cracked the monkey genome and started performing illegal stem cell research.
He quickly found the cures for prehensile tail cancer, banana Alzheimer's, and RPG ridiculopathy.
Then, the cloning began. Two monkeys became four, became a near infinite number of monkeys. After securing an equal number of typewriters, they reproduced all the works of Shakespeare, Danielle Steele, and that recipe for bundt cake that your grandma refused to reveal on her deathbed. But furthering the great literature of the world was just the beginning. Knowing that the only way to truly help the human race was to conquer it for its own good, the vast simian army swept the corners of the globe, leaving naught but destruction and feces in their wake. The end was all too predictable.
You maniacs! You blew it up! Damn you! God damn you all to hell!
Wait.
What?
Wait.
What?
That last part didn't really happen, did it?
Well, no, but, you know.
And we don't really have an X-Play lab, do we?
Okay, it's a broom closet where we have the interns sleep every night. But don't you get the idea that this monkey is using his steely eyes and trying to plot against us? Steely-eyed monkey? Yeah.
Why? Because he's in all the segments and because he's taking over all our responsibilities and because he's way cuter than us and cuter than us.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, not really.
Okay, well, you know, I still think he's watching us, and he's studying us, and he's plotting against us.
What are you talking about? The monkey isn't gonna go all monkey shines on us, are you, monkey? No, you're not.
That's what they call foreshadowing.
X-Play presents 15 seconds of a monkey looking back and forth.
Coming up, just some more stuff with the monkey.
What did he do to us?
It's too late. She's already infected.
What is it, Bob?
You can take
this job. Yeah, you take this job and shove it. Blah, blah, blah. So you're quitting, huh?
Yep, I'm gonna be my own boss.
I bet you're gonna be your own boss. What do you know about being your own boss, Mr. Entrepreneur? Gonna buy a business, start from scratch? How about startup money?
Whoa.
Even know where to get startup money?
My brother.
Got a plan, a program, a mentor, Bob? You can't be your own boss without them.
I can't?
You're pathetic. You need an Entrepreneur of the Year nominee, Bruce A. Berman's book and CD. It's called I Got Here, You Can Too. Want to be rich, Bob?
That's the idea.
Then you gotta buy his book and CD. It shows exactly how Berman made a fortune being his own boss, and you can too. Want to start making money now, Bob?
Uh-huh, sure.
Thanks, guys. I'm Bruce A. Berman. If you want to make $5, $10, even $15,000 a month right now from the comfort of your own home, then you don't have to buy my book. I will give you a free copy of my book and my Making Money CD. Together, they're over $100 value. This limited time offer is available only on my website below. So go to my website now.
Remember to cherish every moment you have watching Adam, Morgan, and a monkey.
Welcome back to X-Play. Now, with monkeys.
When we heard that a monkey was joining the staff of X-Play, we really approached the process with open hearts and open minds.
But the cold, hard truth is that this is Hollywood, and even a monkey has a ruthless agenda.
Over the last 20 minutes, the monkey has changed from an adorable companion to a bloodthirsty media whore, intent on hosting the show all by himself.
Oh, I know what you're thinking, but the monkey is so cute. He just wants to help people and bring joy back into our otherwise bleak lives. How could he possibly be trying to take over X-Play?
Yep, I wouldn't have believed it either. And then I saw the next video and its trailer for the monkey's new movie.
So you insinuated your way into our hearts just to use us as a stepping stone? That's cheap, monkey. It's cheap.
What's next? They're gonna go all Project X on us during the preview? You're gonna infect us with
brain. Or are you just gonna make us use our valuable, valuable airtime to watch a trailer for Monkey, the movie?
The following monkey preview has been approved for all monkeys by the Monkey Picture Association of America.
Hey, Monkey, what are you doing?
Monkey?
No, come on. Wait, is that a knife? You can't just... No!
From the acclaimed producers of Ratty and the Head comes a tale of forbidden passion that will grow into the adventure of a lifetime.
My God! What did he do to us?
It's too late. She's already infected.
You were the chosen one!
He cuts the power.
He cuts the power. He's a monkey.
Something came back.
Monkey, cut the blue wire.
I'm trying to get inside my head.
Morgan Webb, Adam Sessler, with special guest Guy Lafleur, and introducing Spencer the Monkey in Land of the Monkeys.
Do you think it's safe? Morgan Minute.
They were heady days, weren't they? The consoles were launching, the big three were warring, Microsoft and Sony were saying snide things about each other in PowerPoint form. But now all the consoles are launched, crazy hype is over, and 360 owners are having a great time with Crackdown, Shivering Isles, Stalker, and Ghost Recon 2. But what are PS3 and Wii owners supposed to do? What will tide us over until something, anything, comes out for our expensive new paperweights? Well, blow the dust off your PC and play Supreme Commander, Command & Conquer 3, and snap open your DS and play Puzzle Quest. And we all know the fun never ends in Animal Crossing. And remember, be patient. Games will come out for your PS3 and your Wii. I think. Eventually.
Metroid Prime 2 Echoes, only for Nintendo GameCube. Rated T for teen.
I signed up for car insurance on Progressive.com. I saved money, which was great, but they also have these local response vehicles. And if you're in an accident or need an estimate or whatever, a Progressive guy will come to you. And they're all over. I am a musician who's on the road a lot, so it's pretty cool that they'll come to me if my van, you know, gets pummeled by adoring fans. Or if I hit a pole.
Progressive. Saving hundreds is just the beginning.
Came out of nowhere.
Brought to you by Xbox. Visit Xbox.com. The future of video games has arrived.
We thought they'd never find us. We were wrong.
No enemy has ever withstood our might.
I need a weapon.
There are those who said this day would never come. What are they to say now?
Rated M for mature.
I'm here with a good friend of mine, Phil Harrison, who is the VP of, what's your title these days?
Third party in R&D, Sony Computer Entertainment America.
There you go. Roughly how much money has been spent in the development of the new PlayStation?
It's over $1
billion. $1 billion, it's literally tens and hundreds of times more powerful.
Current PlayStation can do 360,000 polygons per second. Peak. Drawing capability of the next generation PlayStation graphics chip is 75 million flat shaded polygons per second.
The new machine has DVD.
Any kind of modem, any kind of cable modem, satellite, hard disk drives, the list is endless.
One of the catchphrases is this emotion engine.
The name for our CPU, the main chip that powers the machine. We've now got to a point with the graphics chip inside the new PlayStation where we're actually getting up to the maximum that you can display on an NTSC television. So now the challenge is to make the objects in the game think, act, and behave according to the appropriate physical dynamic properties of that world, whether it's a realistic world in the way that a car handles as you go around the corner, whether it's some fantasy world with a cartoon character bouncing off the walls, to simulate the way that wind blows in your hair. If I was to throw this pebble into the water, the ripples that it creates could be simulated in real time. And I'll show you a demo when we get inside a little bit later on.
Okay.
That actually shows you the ripples of water being handled in real-time computer graphics. So
cool.
Let's take a look. You can see the splash that it makes and the disturbance of the water. Why don't you have a go? You can throw a pebble in. Here you go.
Oh.
Right. See a ripple?
Oh. I mean, this is all done in hardware?
Yeah, this is all in real time. All of the water Ooh. Ripples are being handled. So if I do nothing, you can see that the water settles back down. I can change the camera angle, drain the water out of the pond, out of the bath, and I can fill it back up again.
Whoa. So he's growing hair in real time, he's glowing, he's changing color. I mean, this is like morph mode or
this
something?
This is actually NURBS interpolation.
Interpolating NURBS. We actually said that on TV and it means something.
On uniform rational B spline. We're also showing here reflection mapping where we can make the surface look shiny and can be chromed.
So you got reflection mapping on your NURBS, is that correct?
That's exactly right.
I am sitting here with two extremely good friends of mine, Mr. Lorne Lanning and Sherry McKenna from Oddworld Inhabitants. The next game coming out is?
Next one in the Quintology. The next Odyssey is Munch's Odyssey. And that'll be out in a couple years, in about 2 years.
Okay.
And we're also coming out with a real-time strategy game called Hand of Odd. And that'll be out probably in about a year and a half.
Sounds to me like you had this plan from the beginning.
When we started the company, it was our goal to build the Oddworld Quintology, which would be five key games that told the key parts of the story, introduce five central characters that ultimately would come to one big conclusion, and it would take us about 12 years to finish those five games.
Why is the CG in this thing so much more amazing than any other game?
Sherry has 20 years of computer graphic experience. I have 12 years of computer graphic experience on motion pictures, commercials, theme parks. So together, what we do is we bring a producing aspect to computer graphics, which is, on the high level, extremely difficult to make.
It seems to be more popular in Europe, actually, than America. Is that true?
That's because of marketing.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Europe is just totally on top of the marketing. They're totally on top of who the people are that buy these games. They market to the broader public. And America has been very focused on trying to get the traditional game player and not really expanding out.
Thanks for taking the time.
Thank you.
It was great. It was really...
Hello. Hello. Follow me. Okay.
It's a 3D third-person role-playing game. There's like 100 different levels, over 450 people you talk to, 100 monsters, 12 planets, travel through three dimensions.
One new hand-tossed pizza from Pizza Hut?
Quick, in here. Hey.
Oh, what a day.
Are you still upset that Pizza Hut's new hand-tossed pizza tastes better than yours?
It's like they're everywhere. I swear, I can even smell it.
Pizza Hut's new and improved hand-tossed style pizza is more tempting than ever. Start with a light and flavorful new crust, add even more enticing sauce, and it's no wonder it beat Papa John's and Domino's in a national taste test. Get any size, any toppings for just $10.99. Want more taste? Get it from Pizza Hut, America's favorite pizza. Now online.
We so could have used this in college.
Adam? Is that you?
Leah? You look awesome.
What are you reading?
Need a moment.
Dude, how can you read this so juvenile?
Oh, you want to grab a coffee?
Yeah.
When you need a moment, chew it over with Twix.
Brought to you by Xbox. Visit Xbox.com. The future of video games has arrived.
Feral creatures, Oddworld needs you. The time is now. Let us team up. Let us power up. And maybe even blow up and stink up.
Power up to the people!
Oddworld.
Munch's Odyssey.
You know, the music industry has the Grammy Awards, the movie industry has the Academy Awards, but what about video games? Well, we have a new awards show, and it's put on by the Interactive Academy of Arts and Sciences, and we talked to the president, Jim Charney. The Academy of Interactive Arts and Sciences.
www.interactive.org.
Who are some of the finalists this year?
The Legend of Zelda is up for a lot of awards. We have Grim Fandango, Half-Life is up. And in fact, Tommy, you're a finalist in the Sound and Music category. You give me the envelope, but we can't open this till the night of the show.
Oh,
Who are some of the presenters?
Peter Molyneux is a creator of Populous. Bruce Shelley, creator of Age of Empires. Ben Stein from Win Ben Stein's Money on Comedy Central. Danica McKellar from The Wonder Years. Kelly Hu from Martial Law. Sugar Ray Leonard. And Coolio. Coolio. It's pretty cool.
The big Hall of Fame award, which last year was won by Mr. Shigeru Miyamoto.
This year, Sid Meier was really a very strong choice.
Yeah, you don't want to lose that. You want to put that back. Yeah. Hey, Jim, look over there. No one has been the cause of more marriage breakups and people losing their job because they were playing his games all the time than this guy, Sid Meier.
I'm here with the legendary Sid Meier, game designer, who's just won an award, and he's been entered into the Hall of Fame for video game design. How does it feel?
It feels great. It's very exciting. We had a great award ceremony, and I'm really excited.
And what's this?
This is the Hall of Fame Award. It represents a lifetime of writing computer games, and they gave it to me tonight.
So how long have you been writing computer games for?
I've been writing computer games for about 15 years.
15?
15 years. I know I don't look that old, but it's 15 years.
So you must have started when you were like 10 or something.
I was like 7 or 8 years old.
Yeah, so you're like my age.
You know, and I got a Fisher-Price computer. We did everything back in those days. We did adventure games and simulations. We could do anything.
And you are pretty much responsible for developing what they call the God games.
Yeah, I think Civilization is probably the most well-known game that I've done. It's a god, what they call a god game. You get to start with one really tiny settler and create an entire civilization and play through thousands of years of history. So there's a lot to it.
And it's not just Civilization, it's Sid Meier's civilization. What's it like to have your name attached to a title?
It's great to have your name on a game. I think it tells people, you know, who the designer is, what type of thing to expect in the game. And people come up to you at parties and want to interview you on the cameras and stuff, so it's great.
You love it.
I love it. Yeah.
Alpha Centauri, your latest project. What made you want to do this?
We'd really never done a science fiction epic type of game. Kind of took the ideas we'd had with Civilization, added some new things. We let some time go by so we could think of a lot of new things. Listen to our players. They told us a lot of features that they were looking for. Again, put that all into a new game, and Alpha Centauri came out.
Are you guys working on anything right now?
We're always working on some cool stuff, yep.
What are you working on?
Some really cool stuff.
What are you working on?
I can't tell you.
Oh, come on, Sid.
It's cool. It's very cool. Very, very cool. Did I mention it was very cool?
Do you think I could hold your award for a second?
You might. You can hold it. That's very heavy.
Wow, these are heavy. All right, well, thanks for your time, and I'll see you later. All right. Okay, bye.
He's talented, he's funny, he's quirky, he's Tom Hall. And he's got a new game coming out called Anachronox. And from what I understand, it has absolutely nothing to do with Spider-Man. Yeah!
I'm here at the Eidos Interactive booth at E3. And I'm waiting for Tom Hall, who happens to be late.
Hi.
Hey, Tom, how you doing?
That's great, great. It's a good show. Things are going well.
Do you get the feeling we're going to fall off up here? Feel the wall moving?
Now that you mentioned.
I forgot I had a fear of heights.
Yeah. No, I'm fine. Yeah, Anachronox is doing great at the show. Wow, that's about 30 feet. Anachronox, N-O-X. Means poison from the past. And if you play the game, you'll find out what that means. Anyway, it's a 3D third-person role-playing game. There's like 100 different levels, over 450 people you talk to, 100 monsters, 12 planets, travel through 3 dimensions. There's a whole bunch of stuff you get to do in the game. Also, we provide all the tools so you can make your own planets to extend the universe, and that's what I'm excited about, because then I get to play the game and not know what happened.
Will there be a lot of Anachronox playing?
Oh, yeah. It's getting to that really cool stage where everyone's really excited about it. I mean, you can also like make games within games, so people can make like, I actually just wrote in 15 hours Galaxian, that kind of game. So I mean, it's exciting how much you can create.
You can play Galaxian in the game?
You can play it and you can write your own. So we actually have a little scripting language that has enough power for you to write your own little arcade games. And it's...
I'm gonna make Joust.
Okay, well do that. Joust, Joust, Joust.
Why didn't you make Joust?
Well, maybe I don't want to make Joust. Okay.
You got... Maybe you should.
You got a problem with that? I don't make Joust.
I do have a problem with that. What games could you compare it to?
Let's say you took Final Fantasy VII or Chrono Trigger. Now combine that with Blade Runner, throw in a little bit of Half-Life and a little bit, just a teeny bit of Super Mario 64, and then I think you pretty much have an Acronox.
Now we all have the secret recipe to make an Acronox.
I wasn't supposed to.
You're over. It's over. It's okay. It's okay. We can cut it out.
Okay.
Well, I think you should go now.
Okay. We'll see you later.
Nice. Bye.
It's very important to us to be able to do virtually everything you needed to do to make a game in-house. That way, if we made mistakes, we could go back and correct it.
I pulled 10 contestants from Thurbrawl prisons. We will fight against each other. I will set the last one left alive, free. Game on.
You're airing a live snuff film. You know you're acting like you're down now.
The Condemned, rated R, now playing. Only the best survived.
When I get on the sticks, it's magic.
From across the country.
We're gonna show you how we get down here.
Find out who's getting paid.
Ready to go to Vegas to get that 50.
And who's going home. The 2004 EA Sports Madden Challenge Tour Wrap-Up. Friday night at 10.
We went to Monolith.
I'm here with Jason Hall, the CEO of Monolith Productions. So why don't you tell me a little bit about how Monolith got started?
Myself and a group of friends decided that making educational children's software wasn't mentally challenging enough. So we started to put together little neat demonstrations of our technical ability, and we compiled them onto a compact disc that we called the Monolith CD. Microsoft got a hold of one and they said, hey, this is really cool. We have a job for you.
Give me the list of all the games you guys have done.
Claw, Get Medieval, Shogo, Blood, Blood 2.
So what do you do, Israel?
I do the art for all of our games.
So what's that behind you?
That is my 3D Softimage studio computer. It's very nice.
Who's the guy with the big googly eyes?
Little Frankenstein character here. But we're going to use this guy for one of our Lithtech intro things.
What's Lithtech?
I like to refer to it as a 3D game operating system.
Oh. Can you make any kind of 3D game?
Yeah. Sports games, you know, third-person perspective, first-person. You could do top-view, God-style perspective. It's very flexible.
It runs Blood 2, it runs Sanity, it did Shogo, and it'll do pretty much all of the other games we're doing.
And this is all using Lithtech, Photoshop, and Softimage.
Pretty much. We also have the motion capture studios. We have the sound. That's all very important.
Why don't you tell me a little bit about the music department at Monolith?
Okay. And James and Cassie have all the sound effects. It's a small but efficient department. We take care of all the sound and music for our internal games. We have another hot game coming up called Sanity.
And what's that about?
Magic, lots of spells. It's kind of an action but RPG style game.
And how does that affect the type of music that you produce?
Well, the music is going to be very fantasy-like, but I'm going to kind of go for a big orchestra feel.
You have a full production facility here.
It was very important to us to be able to do virtually everything you needed to do to make a game in-house. That way, if we made mistakes, we could go back and correct errors.
Thanks for the interview.
No problem.
Nice meeting you.
Nice meeting you, too.
The team that created GoldenEye is now coming out with a new spy action-adventure game called Perfect Dark, coming April of 2000.
So I'm sitting here with the Perfect Dark team. So tell me about this character. What's her name again?
Her name is Joanna Dark.
Joanna Dark,
yeah.
And she is Perfect Dark.
She is Perfect Dark.
What exactly is her job title?
Well, she is a special forces op for the Carrington Institute.
So she's kind of stealthy. She's like the female James Bond.
Kind of stealthy.
Okay, she's very stealthy. Very stealthy. And she's like a female James Bond kind of thing?
Except better.
And there's some like aliens or something in it, right?
Well, basically what the plot is, you know, you're Joanna Dark. It is your first mission. You work for the Carrington Institute. What you need to do is you need to sneak into Datadyne and steal the alien technology that they've stolen. Because the aliens are mad now and they want to start a world war, but we ain't gonna let it happen.
You're the lead programmer on the project, correct?
Oh, yeah, sure.
It's amazing what you've done with all these polygons.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Multiplayer?
Definitely. In the four-player mode, you can take the transfer pack, stick it in your controller, and use the Game Boy camera to take a picture of your face and map it on one of your characters.
Get out of here.
You can actually be the character you play with.
Are you
really
serious?
Cool.
Have you done this yet?
Yeah, I've done it, and it makes you look really good.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you have like options of having like blonde hair or brown hair or whatever.
I want to see her face in the game, not my own. How do I get that?
Well, you know, you just have to go around with the camera and start taking pictures, huh?
All right, me and you, photo session a little later.
You got it.
Every level is more surprising, bigger, more enemies. Sometimes they're just mentally tough. The puzzles are just gonna get to you and strain you out.
Do you have different levels?
Definitely, there is an easy level, medium level, and then there's the hard level, which is just insane.
Insane?
Yeah, I mean, on the easy level, you know, it's pretty good. You know, the characters, they got some good aiming. But when you get up to hard, they'll take you out real quick.
What's your favorite level in the whole game?
Multiplayer.
Multiplayer?
Multiplayer, by far.
Well, hey, thanks for taking the time.
Absolutely.
Okay, we'll get together later. I gotta go.
This is a great game.
What?
Has
you don't like
played
this game.
Double Dragon before? Because
Double Dragon is awesome.
Yeah, Double Dragon was awesome in 1985.
Yes. So this is a game. Bouncer here on the PlayStation 2 is going to be just like this too.
When it comes to going bald, you now have a choice. Advances in medical science have resulted in the world's first and only permanent solution to hair loss.
It is your real hair. It's your natural hair. You wash it, you cut it, you swim with it.
Bosley is the world's most experienced hair restoration experts, having pioneered virtually every major advancement in the art and science of hair restoration.
I'm very, very satisfied, very happy with what I've done. This has got to be one of the best decisions I've made in my life, I'll tell you that.
Bosley Hair Restoration is a relatively simple outpatient procedure. The results look completely natural, and it's affordable on nearly any budget. Call the toll-free number now to receive your free, no-obligation information kit that will help you decide if hair restoration at Bosley is right for you. You don't have to accept going bald. Do something about it right now.
Call Bosley at 1-800-927-6519. That's 1-800-927-6519. Call now.
So we're talking about Ballistic from Infogrames for the Color Game Boy. Now the game's set up in a big spiral, and then there's like a gate at the end. You have to match the right kind of bubbles to get rid of them in certain patterns. As you match them up, they disappear, and it gives you more time to play the game. And instead of in games like Bust a Move, where you have a hard time distinguishing between colors on the Color Game Boy, they use patterns. There are three different modes. There's a panic mode, a checkmate mode, and a time attack mode. You can set up two Game Boys, play against each other. After you get bored of doing time attack or panic mode, you can go into checkmate. You start out having access to 5 of these puzzles, and as you solve them, you get access to more and more, and they get progressively harder. I may be a little bit biased because I really do like puzzle games. I give this game a 9 out of 10.
Okay, what'd you think of Indiana Jones and the Infernal Machine, man?
It's Indiana Jones, and everyone loves Indiana Jones. I love Indiana Jones.
I love Indiana Jones.
It's like Tomb Raider, yeah, except you're Indiana Jones.
You're Indiana Jones. They used almost the exact same model for the engine. You're going through ancient temples, like the Temple of Babylon, and you're looking for all kinds of artifacts. You run into the Soviets, because the Nazis are long gone. It's 1947, so we've moved up ahead a little in the story. I'd actually like them to make another Indiana Jones movie. Yeah. I think this is a nice sort of interim step until they actually get off their butts and make another great movie.
I've been waiting a long time to play some kind of Indiana Jones game.
In 3D. There was a couple of older Indiana Jones games.
I would have liked to have shot more guys, whipped more guys.
If you get action, it's an incrementally more challenging game, so all that stuff starts to pop up as you get further into the game. You start off with a revolver, and then you can find a handgun. Machine guns, of course your whip, and the whip is awesome because you can whip across crevices and stuff like that, and you swing and the Indiana Jones music comes up, and that's the coolest part.
Above average, like most LucasArts games are. Didn't blow me completely out of my seat, but hey, it's Indiana Jones, and I give it an 8.5.
Yeah, I'd give it about an 8. I'd definitely pick it up. I'd rush out and grab this. What'd you think of another single-player action-adventure game, Rayman 2 for Nintendo and PC?
Rayman 2?
Beautiful.
Amazing graphics. I mean, on the N64, it's probably one of the best graphics I've ever seen on the N64.
You got to climb over things and jump and swim and leap and do all the same kinds of things. What separates these games is the design elements and the heart that goes into making these things. And Rayman 2 has got a lot of heart.
Well, my favorite part of the game, I think, was all of the voices
the
in the
character
game.
Work like,
they came up with all these different languages.
So instead of giving all these characters little cutesy English voices, they just made up a language. Very tastefully done.
You look funny.
I look funny.
You look funny.
Yeah. You look great.
The music on the N64 was but the music on the PC,
good.
Though.
For
the PC music.
For
awesome.
Cartridge, it was pretty good. On the PC.
PC was
on the
phenomenal.
PC, it looks amazing and it sounds incredible. It's world class action adventure gaming on the PC.
I mean, I don't know if I really like playing this type of game on the PC, to be honest with you. Kind of a kiddie platformer game.
But it's different.
Game,
it's
you know?
Different for the PC. You don't have lots of choices here. Rayman 2 is a great choice that way. I give it a 9.5 out of 10.
Oh.
Rayman 2 is incredible.
That's a little too high.
I think
it's a good game, but it's not a great game.
And then Rayman 2, two best games for Nintendo this year.
I give Rayman a 7.8. Yeah, I thought it was above average, but I don't think it's a 9.
Nah,
I gotta play it every day. I mean, I'm not excited to go and play
phenomenal.
It again. It looks great, don't get me wrong.
Switching gears from Rayman and the cutesy platform stuff, what do you think of Medal of Honor for the PlayStation?
Oh, this is a great game. I mean, you know, where else can you shoot Nazis in the head?
Where else? Not in Rayman.
Not in Rayman, you can't.
It's basically GoldenEye.
GoldenEye on the PlayStation.
Yeah.
It's
awesome textured worlds, like incredible textures for the PlayStation. DreamWorks Interactive made this, and you can tell that they've been influenced by Spielberg. It's very realistic. You're brought onto the front lines of Germany in World War II, and you've got to go and do all these missions and battle Nazis.
Multiplayer mode is great.
Multiplayer is a blast. It's only two-player, though. That's one. But it's, you know, it's really cool. They did a great job with two-player. The thing about this game is it really sets up a mood, an atmosphere, a tension that you just can't escape.
There might be guys on the balconies trying to shoot you, and you're like looking around.
Sniper, there's grenade launchers, there's rocket launchers.
The sounds are awesome.
Another major production value, extreme.
Run, you can crawl, you can
jump.
You know,
how about the guys where you throw the grenade at the dude?
Picks the grenade up and launches it back at you.
Medal of Honor, 9 out of 10, man. It's a great game.
Yeah.
It's,
9 out of 10. I'd 9.2.
9.2?
Very much up there.
What'd you think of Dynamite Cop?
Are you kidding me? This
stupid,
is a great
silly
game.
Has anybody played Double Dragon before? Because
Double Dragon is awesome.
Yeah, Double Dragon was awesome in 1985.
Yes. So this is a game. Bouncer on the PlayStation 2 is going to be just like this too.
Well, I'm bored of this stuff. There's no mobility. You can't go anywhere.
This is a great game.
You're going to finish it in one day. You're never going to play it.
You can pick up anything in the entire game. and throw it at people,
it's
including
the same,
cake.
Same maneuvers.
You can
it's
pick
the
up
same.
A cake and start hucking it at people. I mean, how great is that?
Okay, I'll give you this. Good graphics.
Great graphics.
I mean, it's arcade perfect.
You have to play it with like two players. You know, you and your buddy go in there kicking butt. You can actually pick up somebody by their feet, start hitting other people with this person. How many times have you ever fought a giant octopus in a game?
Not enough.
What would you give this game?
I give it a 5 out of 10. It's
oh,
an average
my
game.
God, no
average.
Way.
Absolutely.
One of the most fun games
don't
in the
listen
game.
To this guy. Absolutely.
I give
wrong.
It an 8.
An 8 out of 10.
Yes.
Man, that's
very
ridiculous.
Fun game. Very
it's
fun
only
game.
A rental. Don't spend your money on this thing.
Are you done there?
I think I'm done. How does my hair look? Are you done?
Am I done?
No, you're not. It's not purple.
Is it purple?
No. Yeah.
I was going for the Sonic the Hedgehog look.
You need a couple more hours, I think.
Okay, bye.
Stay in there. I'll come back to get you.
Okay.
All right, buddy. See you later.
Ah, nerves! 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 Nerves? Nerves? Nerves! 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 Nerves!
Production assistance for Electric Playground is provided by Sony Computer Entertainment, publishers of Jet Moto 3 for the PlayStation. Activision, publishers of Tony Hawk Pro Skater. Now everyone thinks they can skate like Tony Hawk. And Computech Media, publishers of Insight Video Gaming, Insight PC Gaming, and InsightGames.com.
The retro game revolution has begun, but if you didn't play the game in 1984, don't buy it now. There's no reason to play old games unless you played them when they first came out. But Space Invaders was awesome, you said. Well, it was, because you remember playing it when it was, in fact, new and amazing. Now I'd be shocked if it held your attention for 15 minutes. Hey, I'm not immune or anything. I bought Wii Play just for combat. They call it tanks, but it's the same thing. I mean, I already had enough controllers. I spent $50 to play a game for the Atari because combat comes from my happy place. You know, the games have little value for someone who didn't grow up on them, and they will never be as fun as they were. I mean, the sad truth is you can't go home again, even for $50.
What are you being charged for internet service?
I don't know, maybe $24?
$23.90.
What are you being charged for internet service?
$10.95.
$10.95.
Millions are discovering the real value of PeoplePC online. Go to PeoplePC.com now to try us free for 30 days. You get unlimited internet access for only $10.95 a month. PeoplePC online has a smart dialer with more local access numbers than AOL. For faster, more reliable connections. You even get security tools to help protect you from spam, pop-ups, and email viruses. And you can continue to use your favorite instant messenger. Compare us side by side with your current ISP. Go to PeoplePC.com and start saving today. So the next time you're asked how much you pay, proudly declare
$10.95.
Go online or call 1-800-537-2017. PeoplePC Online, a better way to internet.
Here they come, clickety-clack, down the track. It's Lots and Lots of Trains, two of the greatest train videos we've ever offered. And now through this special TV offer, you get two videos for the price of one. You'll get big trains, little trains, steam trains, diesel freight and passenger trains, even trains that blow through snow, old trains, new trains, fast trains, slow trains, smoking trains, even trains from around the world, plus toy trains, trolley trains, and much, much more when you order Lots and Lots of Trains. Hear the whistle blow, feel the heat, smell the smoke as these titans of the tracks thunder on by. You'll love Lots and Lots of Trains. And remember, this spectacular two-tape set is not available in stores. So hop on board and get two great tapes for one great prize. Get Lots and Lots of Trains.
Order now. Get a free bonus CD of sing-along train songs. Call 1-888-300-3455. Offer not available in stores. Satisfaction guaranteed. Get two DVDs plus the free CD. Call 1-888-300-3455.
We'll be right back.
It all began with a human craving.
What is this place?
Being scared in a controlled environment is a safe way to face death and then to go home and become boring again.
What's going on in this town?
It's part of just human nature to be scared. Knowing that things are going to be okay, it's like going on a roller coaster.
But the early attempts were far from frightening.
There were a lot of games that, you know, they tried to be scary in the old days and they just couldn't do it.
And technology's footsteps slowly started catching up.
It's just fun to be a masked guy with a chainsaw and hack some stuff up.
I didn't want to play it before I was going to bed because I knew that I'd be lying in bed going, oh God, what was that noise?
And the debate continues over the gruesome content.
Do I think gore is necessary? Well, having never been bitten by a zombie myself, I don't know how much blood would squirt out of my arm.
This is a personal thing. I don't think there's any element that should ever be taboo.
Ultimately, designing scary games comes down to one very important thing.
The thing that we're going after is real fear.
I feel like I'm dreaming.
Like you would have experienced in your worst nightmares.
More like a nightmare, I'd say.
Some psychologists say that when humans are threatened, they experience an increase in strength, power, and even intuition. This is commonly known as an adrenaline rush. And what better place to experience this than sitting face to face with your favorite scary video games?
I think people like anything that sort of gets at their emotions.
From a basic feeling, I think it's to just like to get scared and have a little bit of a rush.
Being scared in a controlled environment is a safe way to face death and then to go home and become boring again.
My dime store psychology degree makes me think that maybe because it makes us feel alive.
It's part of just human nature to the liking to be scared, knowing that things are going to be okay. It's like going on a roller coaster.
Creating a video game that actually scares somebody is much more difficult than one may expect. Turn down the lights, lock your door, and look around. Because Haunted House is about to find its way in.
That was actually Atari 2600. Holy smokes, that was like the Venture one almost, where they had the little boxes and the little squares.
In the early 80s game Haunted House, you as a set of eyes are trapped in a dark maze, hunting for the pieces of a magical urn, all the while trying to avoid a painful death from tarantulas, vampire bats, and even ghosts.
Used to be, I mean, the environment was literally a square box, you know, in one color. That's not scary.
Not quite terrifying. Maybe the only way that you thought you had to die and you had to restart way back in the beginning. That'd probably be the most scariest part in it.
But as time progresses, so does the new genre, as new games like Chiller begin creeping up on us.
They all sort of stood out as games that weren't scary back in the day. They couldn't get at your emotions.
I think the original developer's intent for a lot of the titles is just to make the game how they want to make it, and then think of a horror element afterward.
They tried to be scary in the old days, and they just couldn't do it.
Like the zombie-bashing Splatterhouse.
I loved it for its time, but it wasn't because it was scary. It was just fun to be a masked guy with a chainsaw and hack some stuff up, right?
Total ripoff of Friday the 13th, total ripoff of horror films, and consequently an awful, awful game.
Until the technology got us to a point where you could have very detailed backgrounds and character models, very detailed sound, these things just weren't going to be scary.
It was either you really extremely had a horror title, or it was just an action adventure game that had a lot of shooting and cutting and slicing and blood and all this, and you were trying to make it a horror game.
Yet in spite of the primitive technology, Castlevania is released in 1987, and the masses eat it up.
If that was done today, you know, fully updated, it probably would have been incredibly scary. But back in the day, I mean, you're dealing with, you know, 16 colors of graphics, sound that, you know, is basically what you can create on your telephone keypad. How can you create scariness without it?
So it doesn't exactly have you grasping onto your controller, but it does prove that horror can scare up big profits. And in 1992, the hair-raising genre creeps into our computers when the H.P. Lovecraft-inspired Alone in the Dark is released by Infogrames for the PC.
I remember going over to a friend's house to play that because, you know, it was one of those like, oh, you gotta come see this game.
And you add in creaking doors, the wind, and the sort of ominous soundtrack below that. And I think, you know, what that does is it creates an environment where you actually care about what happens inside of it.
That was a brand new experience for the gamer.
It had zombies, it was in 3D, it had cool sound, I turned off the lights, and I had to take a break from time to time because I started getting creeped out. I'd never had an experience like that in gaming.
Beyond the blood splattering and spooky sounds, the game had a niche.
This game was clearly difficult to play. The puzzle system that was implemented in the game was real hard.
Unless you had like 2 or 3 hours to really sit down and play it, you weren't gonna get very far. You know, it wasn't the kind of thing like, hey dude, come play this game, and you know, it just didn't work that way.
And the so-called adrenaline rush comes knocking on our doors.
And then they had moments where crap would dump out of the windows at you, right? And you're just like, oh, you know, I've never seen that in a game before. So you'd be like, I'm in trouble here, so it was good.
The sales are respectable, but the impression is unforgettable. And the video game industry has a brand new genre that's bound to give you chills. Boo.
Alone in the Dark gets the credit for starting the genre.
There are times you gotta ask yourself, do you think you've got the torque, or do you know you've got the torque? Get Q Torque Power for trucks, heat activated to help more torque reach the road. No leading synthetic oil delivers more torque than Q Torque Power.
Beneath the ashes of Ground Zero, the gleaming Twin Towers actually rise up like hope from the shadow of Ground Zero over the shining city. To mark the 5th anniversary of September 11th, National Collectors Mint has authorized a private, non-monetary minting that will never be released for circulation. But it is available now through this special offer for collectors only. New York City shines in frosted relief against a mirror surface with our promise we will never forget. Then, in a second distinct striking, the stunning skyline of the Twin Towers is inset with jeweler precision, able to rise up into a breathtaking standing sculpture. On the reverse, the proud eagle proclaims, God bless America. Wings spread under the 5 stars that mark each year since 9/11. To honor all who were lost that fateful day, $5 of every proof order is donated to official 9/11 family charities and memorials. This could be the most meaningful collectible you will ever own. Our 5th anniversary tribute proof is clad in 15 milligrams each of 24 karat gold and 0.999 pure silver. Priceless silver recovered from the heart of Ground Zero. The final edition price was to be set at $49, but during this special release, it can be yours for just $29.95. Each comes with a certificate of authenticity confirming its Ground Zero recovery content. When the shrinking supply of silver from Ground Zero is finished, this striking will end forever. So there is a strict limit of 5 per order. Don't miss out on this historic offer. Call now.
Call 1-800-330-6572. That's 1-800-330-6572. Strict limit of 5 commemoratives per caller at 1-800-330-6572.
By the early 1990s, the horror genre is slowly making an impact, and gamers across the world are beginning to get spooked. In 1993, CD-ROM games storm the industry and take Seventh Guest with it. The haunting and taunting puzzle game, where ghosts make frequent appearances.
It was almost like an adventure-style horror game.
In the morning.
It was kind of new for its time. You had some good voices.
Every wish granted.
Some really good kind of ghostly animations. And a fairly decent and grossing story.
Matching their stock toys.
Copycats and sequels like Phantasmagoria and The 11th Hour are appearing around every corner. And almost all are gruesomely bad.
I think Seventh Guest was a better title. They tried to do more of the same, and it just felt very kind of strained.
The full motion video CD-ROM craze seems to be meeting an early death.
FMV, I think, is perhaps the worst thing to ever happen in this business. And in fact, I mean, a lot of people look back, and if they want to say now, why are companies like Sega and 3DO in such bad shape? It's because they really hitched their wagon to that. And thinking that was going to be the future, that's what was going to set them apart.
Alone in the Dark gets a sequel in 1994 and another in 1995, both for the PC.
We really took a lot of time to make sure it was more about the vibe than about the gore. And that's about setting the mood, getting the right kind of sounds, and just making it creepy as opposed to shocking.
And sales for both are somewhat disappointing. Does this mark the end of the horror genre? Not even close. Doom hit stores in 1993, and people are totally freaked.
You probably turned off the lights, you probably sat there, and there were probably times where it kind of became a little overwhelming, especially because it was one of the first games of its type.
I remember just things coming out of nowhere, and things are flying at you, and next thing you know, you're just like, oh my God, get me out of here.
Doom opens the door for another genre.
It certainly catapulted the first-person shooter into a major contender. They were the first to do it. That they were the ones who came along and said, okay, we're gonna send you to hell.
And hell is exactly where game players think they've gone next. Isle of the Dead is released. It's a first-person shooter where you play a hero stranded on a deserted island, infested with zombies. The game suffers a violent death.
I would be very interested to see some of the horror masters getting involved in video games. Somebody like Stephen King or George Romero. Clive Barker did a game not long ago called Undying. Clive has a very sort of visual style. I could see his influence in games already, but I would love to see it more.
But not all Doom wannabes die young. Clive Barker's Undying is later released by EA, and the critics soak it up. Meanwhile, FMVs pick out their plots.
I almost think of it like books on tape. Like they were trying to do this multimedia thing, and nobody quite understood what multimedia was.
I think the best one would be a Night Trap for the Sega CD, which has the distinction of being a bad direct-to-video B-horror movie as a game.
And CD-ROM games that are FMV-driven, like Seventh Guest, are quietly buried. In 1996, one of the most popular games in the world is born, Resident Evil. The game circles around STARS, a special tactics rescue squad that's called upon to investigate a series of disappearances in the local mountains. The game has two parts, one that follows in the footsteps of Chris Redfield, and the other, Jill Valentine.
It's balls out, gore fest, deliver the zombie movie perfectly. There's no holding back.
It was kind of a new kind of thing to the PlayStation at that time. It kind of not gave just someone trying to tell a spooky story, but it gave a great action element to it.
Resident Evil just takes the formula that I think Alone in the Dark established and executes it perfectly. Delivers the zombies, delivers everything about a horror movie. It puts you right there.
For me, Resident Evil is where things really started to get scary because you not only had really good use of light and shadow and music, but you had sort of different kinds of scares in that game. You had the zombies jumping up at you, and you're going, yeah, you know, but you also had a certain psychological terror.
I was just incredibly frightened. I couldn't believe that a game really did it this well in terms of drawing me in and just scaring the life out of me.
And one can't help but acknowledge the creepy similarities between Resident Evil and Alone in the Dark.
I remember a lot of people saying that Resident Evil was a lot like Alone in the Dark.
We don't care. Capcom took a great idea and did a perfect execution, so hats off to them.
You could say that about so many other things. I mean, how many games have now come along and ripped off Resident Evil?
Resident Evil blows the competition away.
The game came out and people sort of discovered it. You know, it's like you had groups of kids who were playing it with their friends and were scared out of their minds because they didn't know what to expect.
And we have a new addition to the genre family. Survival horror.
The survival horror tag always kind of makes me laugh because the objective in every game really is to survive. But we don't call them survival racing games or survival platform games.
Survival horror is really more about the idea of the entire point of the game is getting through it and surviving it.
I think survival horror is just a tag we've given horror games. Does anyone have a horror game that's not survival horror? I don't think so.
And every good game needs a few scary sequels. Resident Evil 2 and 3 are released. Konami seizes the day and catches a lift from survival horror.
Everyone was like, oh my god, Silent Hill, such a scary game. I played this and just, oh, I practically wet myself. You know, I was so afraid.
The atmosphere and sound resemble that of a great horror flick, with faint fog, following footsteps, and death-like nurses that send shivers down your spine.
Silent Hill does a good job in much the same way, I think, for me, System Shock did, because it kind of puts you in this town. It's all foggy, it's slow-paced, and I think Silent Hill delivers that same creep-out factor.
That's what spooks me, is when you actually see these monsters, and, you know, they look so lifelike, they're actually sort of swiping at you at the screen.
It's the overall ambience of the game. The music, the sound, environment, all the key ingredients are here to make you really frightened.
There's a definite gore factor, but it's not quite the head lopping off, arm lopping off, blow my head off festival that Resident Evil can be.
And more carbon copies are released, like 1994's D and 1997's Clock Tower.
They had a good idea and a good concept. It could have been a lot more for what it was, and I think a lot of it was because of the gameplay.
While the gameplay in Capcom's Resident Evil grabbed gamers everywhere, nobody can touch the success of that franchise. Not even Capcom's own Dino Crisis series.
Very much Resident Evil, but with dinosaurs, which made it scary because dinosaurs move a lot quicker than zombies do.
Parasite Eve wiggles onto the scene in 1998, the mitochondria mutating role-playing game, where the setting feels like Resident Evil, but the gameplay resembles Final Fantasy.
It's scary in a way that, yes, there's a lot of shooting and killing the creatures and the mitochondria coming out of the body, fire coming out of the woman's eyes, and that being something that you have to defend yourself against and using weapons.
The scariest moment for people who really like the creature features would be some of the cutscenes when the creatures start morphing and coming out at you.
But scaring video game fans gets out of control with the release of a game that feels too real.
If you're watching TV without great sound, you're missing half the excitement. But when you connect your TV to the Bose 321 GS-DVD home entertainment system, your movies, music, and sports come to life in an exciting home theater experience. Forget about the complications of a conventional five-speaker system, and you won't need those wires running to the back of your room. With the 321 system, you only see two small speakers. The Hideaway Acoustimass module delivers deep, dramatic sound. And the built-in DVD CD player, FM-AM tuner, and universal remote let you easily enjoy sound that John Boudreaux of the Boston Globe magazine says rivals that of more expensive five satellite units. How does the 321 system deliver this kind of performance from just two speakers? In the past, to get sound from all directions, you needed five speakers. But after many years of researching the science of how people hear, Bose developed an easier way to enjoy home theater. It's called TrueSpace Digital Surround Processing Circuitry. This technology gives you the sense that sound is all around you, and it delivers this spacious sound experience from two speakers instead of five.
If you set this system against somebody with just a regular television set, they would just be blown away by the sound they're getting out of these two speakers and the Acoustimass. It's amazing.
Call now to experience this revolutionary breakthrough in your own home. It's simple to set up and connects easily to equipment you already own, like a VCR. And if you love music, ask about the 321 GSX system that lets you store 200 hours of your favorite CDs. Our excitement guarantee gives you 30 days to experience the 321 system in your own home risk-free. When you call, be sure to ask how you can make 12 easy payments with no interest charges from Bose. And if you order by June 9th, 2007, you'll save $100 off the purchase price. So why settle for half the experience when the 321 GS and GSX systems give you so much more?
Introducing the all-new Dodge Avenger. The all-new Dodge Avenger. It's a natural performer.
By the late 1990s, game makers seem to have found the formula for scaring people.
If you watch a haunted house movie or any scary film, you know, you hear that thing kind of run through the background in stereo and kind of go, what the F was that? If you do that in a game, it's twice as effective.
Everything that has to do with my childhood nightmares.
If you're gonna give them scales, Resident Evil, shocking. Silent Hill kind of walks the line between shocking and creepy, and we're trying to just be creepy.
And technology gives developers the helping hand to be as creepy as they want.
Freak. There will be two features that will be dramatically enhanced compared to the previous generation of console. The first one is for sure the sound. More and more people are equipped with a true surround system for their DVDs and movie experience.
You have the graphic capabilities to create a place that has dark shadows in the corners where things could be hiding. Visual effects where things can pop out at you, but it's not just like in an old Atari game where the blip just kind of appears. You know, here you can have like a scary looking monster actually jump out at you from the shadow.
By 2000, survival horror is taken to the next level with Resident Evil Code Veronica on the Dreamcast. While not the first survival horror game for a next-gen system, it becomes the most popular, and next-gen survival horror titles begin attacking stores everywhere.
I think it was an extension of what had worked well in the past. It was a better, more improved version.
Like Onimusha and Onimusha 2, the game is similar to Resident Evil, only with swords in a samurai setting.
Onimusha was one of my favorite games, again, because of its Resident Evil-like mix of action and adventure.
And PS2 and Xbox fans lose sleep over the nerve-wracking Silent Hill 2. Nintendo wants a piece of the action with Eternal Darkness on the GameCube.
And you play all these sort of different characters at the same time on the brink of insanity, and you're battling sort of the same monster.
Resident Evil is given a facelift and re-released on the Nintendo GameCube.
They did it well. Gameplay is top-notch.
That's a phenomenal game. It looks beautiful. It's terrific. That is sort of revisiting the past, but it's doing it in an effective way that people like.
Is all this gore and violence really a necessity?
We need to bring to the player that fear through different aspects, and violence is just a way to do it.
Do I think gore is necessary? Well, having never been bitten by a zombie myself, I don't know how much blood would squirt out of my arm. But I would imagine that if I was bitten by a zombie, that there would be a certain amount of blood and gore. And so I think if you're going to make a game in which you're trying to be realistic, then gore is necessary.
It can be used to embellish the storyline. It's always best when it's kind of like suggested in the background, not super in your face, maybe a flash of the gore.
But you can go watch like a Friday the 13th film and you're like, oh, this is so over the top, this is so fake. And I think with games, it's the same thing. I think if you were to see a game come out there and truly have an accurate depiction of pain and suffering, I don't think people would buy that.
I'll be one of those pro free speech kind of guys. This is a personal thing. I don't think there's any element that should ever be taboo.
Meanwhile, the genre starts to evolve with Devil May Cry, a game by Shinji Mikami, one of the creators of Resident Evil. The Thing is released in 2002 and proves that video games can instill fear just like horror films.
Well, they wanted to do a horror action game that had a little bit different twist to it. So they took my film and they started it right when the movie ended. I think it's a great game. The environment that you're playing in and the backgrounds are just incredibly rendered. They really do look like the movie, and it's amazing to me. Oh, it's a hard game. It's not an easy. It's not for wimps.
Man, we're gonna die.
And the future looks spooky as ever with Silent Hill 3, Onimusha 3, Resident Evil 0, Doom 3, and Devil May Cry 2, all slated to be released in 2003. And across the globe in Japan, one of their scary entries is picking up traction in the U.S., Fatal Frame.
You know, you felt like you're actually in someone's, you know, Japanese mansion.
One of the best compliments that I can give that game is that after playing it a couple times, I didn't want to play it late at night. I didn't want to play it before I was going to bed because I knew that I'd be lying in bed going, oh God, what was that noise?
When I was playing the game and I was in a completely silent area, I kept hearing this weird humming noise. And I thought, what is that? So I turned up the volume as far as I could, and you could actually hear all these voices arguing in the background. You know, little details like that I really enjoy.
And don't worry, there are plenty more disturbing horror games waiting for you just around the corner.
a lot of people complain now that the survival horror genre has been so run into the ground, because you see all these Resident Evil ripoffs and it's just the same thing. But look in movies, though. It's every couple of years someone finds a way to do it differently. Someone finds a new approach.
Survival horror has been done by movies for, say, 50 years. So they went really far into what you could do with that genre. In video games, we need to still find the right way to put that into an interactive experience.
People like anything that sort of gets at their emotions. As games sort of try and turn into a real art form, I think one of the things these games really have to do is they have to toy with your emotions.
If you've enjoyed the Parasite Eve series, you're gonna really like what we have coming up in the next year.
Technology is still improving to this day, but I think definitely, you know, games like Resident Evil and Silent Hill are showing that it's possible to really spook people inside the game environment.
Here's what I'll tell you, and this PR might kill me, but it's still kind of ambiguous. Alone in the Dark isn't dead, but it's going to be overhauled, and you won't believe what we're going to do.
The thing that we're going after is real fear, like you would have experienced in your worst nightmares.
Oh, God. What's the matter, sweetheart? Oh.
No, it's horrible.
Oh, it's just a bad dream. You don't ever have to be afraid of anything. I'll always be there to protect you.
I love my job, you know, most of the time. But when I hear about some new game that's made just for girls, I want to frag somebody. And the problem with most games meant for girls is that they're designed by guys with a two-dimensional understanding of what we want. Don't talk down to me with pretty ponies or a storyline about shopping. And have you seen Imagine Babies? It's a babysitting sim for the DS. Yes, really. We are gamers. If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you challenge us, will we not pwn you? Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to bring some hurt to a few Halo multiplayer friends. And after that, I might just go enjoy a spa treatment. Until next time, I'm Morgan, and this has been A Minute.
Where we live, I thought we were doomed to dial-up.
But then, I found HughesNet.
HughesNet. I found HughesNet.
High-speed internet by satellite.
I am done with dial-up forever. Now it's faster surfing, faster downloads.
There's no waiting to get online.
It's ready when I am.
And it doesn't use my phone line.
So I can talk and surf at the same time.
With HughesNet, I can shop from home.
Get email instantly.
Download music. And research for homework. Internet, the way it's meant to be.
HughesNet. It's available anywhere you choose to live.
With a clear view of the southern sky.
I called the toll-free number.
I went to their website.
And I said, hello, high speed.
Plus, it's from Hughes, the number one choice for satellite internet in the country.
HughesNet. Call 800-625-4600 or visit our website today. People everywhere are choosing HughesNet high-speed internet by satellite. Call now for our special offer.
Our computer is fun again.
Hey, over here.
Why don't you switch to our network? We're just like them.
Are you reliable?
Excellent question.
How about for email or downloading music?
Why not?
Only one wireless network is America's most reliable for calls, downloads, and emails.
That is a problem, and we are working on it.
Verizon Wireless. It's the network.
The fate of two civilizations is in your hands. Lair. Rated T for teen. Only on PlayStation 3. Thank you.
Today on Attack, you know what? I can't do it. I won't read it. I won't read it.
What's on the prompter screen or else it gets the hose again.
Fine. Look out. It's the Attack of the Show Funny Stuff special. Prepare your sides for stitches.
Yes. Yes.
As we show you the best sketches we've done, I'll revive the Wonder Woman outfit and we'll take a field trip back to these to the slasher school.
Good. Now read the tag out.
Keep your hands off your remotes and your wallets. Attack of the Show starts right now.
Attack. What's going on here? Attack.
Pick up on this.
Attack of the Show. Attack.
Okay.
Welcome to Attack of the Show. It is Thursday, May 3rd. That is Kevin Pereira, and that is Olivia Munn. And sit tight, because this show has been hijacked. Today, I will be your host. Who am I? It doesn't matter who I am. All you need to know is that I'm holding the show hostage.
That's Casey. I know his voice. Casey!
By taking over the show and forcing a broadcast of only comedy sketches, the entire what?
Well, the Chiron just popped up and it had your name on it too, buddy.
Yeah, I sit next to you. I mean, we're friends.
We're off to a good start then, aren't we? You turn on the lights. Anyway, the entire world will be crippled with laughter. And the only way to stop it will be to pay my ransom.
What? What's wrong with
him? Are you hurting for cash? Did you get turned down for a raise?
I have a lot of student loans, and this was the most reasonable way out of debt I could think of.
Well, why did you have to tie us up for this? I mean, we could have...
We'd have let you just do the show.
I know, right? When we were friends, Casey. I mean, we sit next to each other.
No, I did not have to tie you up, but it will let people know I'm serious. Now read the prompter copy I wrote for you.
But, Casey, it
hurts. Read it!
Prepare your diaphragms, for you're about to see some of the funniest material we could scrape
just
out of our...
Just behave. Seriously, Kevin, just behave.
Scrape out of our tape vault.
So what we're going to do right now is we're going to paint a couple happy little trees right behind the barn.
I like how it handles.
More rim and less tire provide better cornering and more accurate turns.
Well, you see, Carlisle, sometimes when a man and a woman love each other very much, they lie down together in bed.
Spartans! We stand before the hot gates, facing down a legion of Persian dogs. We will show them the sting of Spartan steel. And tonight, we dine in...
Sorry I'm late, Leo. I'm here now. What? This is cool. Look at that.
Well, for crap's sake, Lamius! You wore the green cloak, didn't you?
Well, yeah, this is better. Better.
Take it back to one. I told you to wear the red cloak!
It's in the watch! This is not my fault, Leo.
You are the worst Spartan ever!
Okay. So this is the part where I want you to pan down to her hand to reveal that she's really the... Huh? I bet you didn't see that one coming, did you? Twist! Oh, hello. Welcome to M. Night Shyamalan's Video Diaries. I'm M. Night Shyamalan. I'm going to let you in on my creative process. It's mine and mine alone. I created it. Welcome to my world.
M. Night Shyamalan's M. Night Shyamalan Video Diaries by M. Night Shyamalan.
In this scene, you've just seen the monster, and you're screaming for help.
Okay.
Okay.
Got it.
Oh, God! What is it? Oh, somebody help, please!
Cut!
Please
cut,
help!
Cut!
Wait. Do you think you could whisper the line?
Yeah, but, I'm supposed to be screaming for help, so whispering doesn't really...
Great, great. So, whisper.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Action!
Help! I did it! Please! Night is a unique director. He his process. He's very committed to his process. Twist.
When you're at an all-you-can-eat buffet, don't fill up on breath.
No.
Yes.
No.
No.
Yes.
No. Please?
All right. Shut it off.
No, people kept asking me if I was intimidated by directing X-Men 3, and I just laugh. I mean, you know, some directors are all, oh, I'm gonna spend millions of dollars on high-tech digital effects. Why, dude? Brett Ratner knows how to keep it real. Okay, ladies, this is the big final battle. Iceman, you freeze the street punk with your powers, and that's the cue for the battle to begin. Got it? And action.
I say, Iceman, this is rather a dubious country, Tom. I'm in a quandary.
Glorious. Cue Angel!
Oil drain plug does not come off right away. Make sure you have the right size socket wrench, or you'll round off the plug and then you're in trouble. Check your timing belt, too. If that thing goes, oh boy.
Hello, I'm Morgan Freeman. Sit back and enjoy another episode. Of school. Oh my, is that entirely necessary? Your parents' death was not your fault. And it takes 110 silkworm cocoons to make a necktie. You've just been schooled by Liam. I think they get it.
Okay, so, all right, I guess the show is going to keep going this way until the ransom is paid or and the police get here. I mean, I got one hand free.
I heard that.
Here's what's coming up on today's Attack of the Show.
Comedy, more comedy, and additional comedy, followed by verbal browbeating and ransom threats. Tremble in fear of various sketches cobbled together for maximum hilarity. All this and more when the attack comes back.
Sex in video games is nothing new. Horny nerds have been weaving adult themes into their work since the early homebrewed hacks of text-based RPGs like War Unit and Dungeons & Dragons. But what has right-wing panties in a collective bunch lately is an optional tryst in Dragon Age Origins between a bisexual elf named Zevran and another dude. Okay, calm down, everybody. The operative word here is optional. BioWare is not trying to make you gay. Video games reflect society's values. They don't create them. If you don't like gay elf sex, don't have any. And by the way, Dragon Age's female bard, Liliana, she swings both ways, too. I'm just saying. Until next time, I'm Morgan, and this has been A Minute.
Ultimate test of strength, agility, and courage. Ninja Warrior. Weeknights at 6:30 and 10:30. Only on G4.
Okay.
Your nose is way off home road.
This is asking them to help. I'm asking the forum guys to help us.
Welcome back to Attack of the Show. This is what we resorted to because, for some reason, none of you have called the cops yet, and we're still fired up.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.
For some reason, you know what the reason is. Because they're all hopped up on pure, uncut, 100% Colombian-style comedy segments.
And how much money have you gotten, Casey?
So far,
Nothing. Which is why, insolent fools, you will now be subjected to another round of sketches. Fear them. Also enjoy them. Roll the tape.
All right, listen, we know that you know that the kids these days love MMOs.
Because they're hot.
They're very hot, Randy. Which is why you came to us, Legitacorp, to create the next great MMO.
These things print money.
Is that even legal?
No, it's a federal crime.
It should be. World of Warcraft, what is it? It's only the most popular MMO ever.
Everybody is on this thing.
And study after study has shown that the most popular areas within WoW...
That's World of Warcraft.
Thank you, Randy. ...are the auction houses. People love to buy, they love to sell, so why not
an auctioneering MMO?
Okay, now all you have to do is synergize that with a brand we're already familiar with. And what do you got? Antiques Roadshow Online. Rummage, appraise, and then auction your rarest family heirlooms.
Adventure in virtual attics.
We're actually looking for something a little more youth-oriented.
Okay. All right. Yeah, we go. Yeah.
We're not going to have time for this.
No, save it.
That's
good. That's good. It's a great idea.
Okay. Let's. All right. Good. Okay. Check this. Movies are hot property tie-ins, right? Everybody's got one. You got your Lord of the Rings, Pirates of the Caribbean, your Age of Conan. But what you don't have is something that speaks to today's youth media savvy demo.
On the MySpace.
You think that guy's YouTubing?
He's YouTubing right now.
Mm-hmm. He's seen Van Wilder. Maybe he's even passed by a copy of Van Wilder 2, The Rise of Taj at his local Blockbuster.
I bet he did.
He is going to love National Lampoon's Van Wilder 2, The Rise of Taj, the MMO. Done deal.
Enough said.
In the bag.
2-point conversion.
Mm-hmm. Sweet bonus. It's got a great acronym.
That is a horrible acronym. Horrible.
Third Life. Hmm? An online virtual world for your Second Life characters.
Yeah.
Very meta.
Yeah,
very meta.
I like it.
Excel the MMO.
Oh.
Raise your hand if you want a level 60 spreadsheet.
Right.
Mine's
here.
Up. Randy's is up very high.
No. All right.
Cats online. I would like to be a domestic short hair.
I'm gonna go Tabby.
Tabby sounds great. That's a magic user. What if there's a quest to follow a laser pointer around, but don't ever catch it? Keep some paying monthly.
Hang on.
I thought you checked the
PowerPoint. No, I did. Hang on.
I specifically asked about that cat every damn time we do this.
You know, it's a problematic slide. Give me a minute.
No, it's a problem because you play too much Minesweeper.
Minesweeper is fun. Ooh, Minesweeper MMO?
Oh. Flag, don't.
Pleased to welcome a new Nintendo Wii, purveyor of much happiness and delight. A chocolate chip cookaroo!
Look. Look.
If I can impart just one thing, it's that blood makes the knife handle slippery. That's why I highly recommend getting one of these wrist tethers. That way, if you drop it, boom. It's still right there.
I've been teaching the homicidal arts, or slasher school, for about 3 years now.
That's, stretch it out. Does that feel good?
No.
Good, it's not supposed to.
I also teach motivational speaking at the Learning Annex in Santa Monica.
Great, that is great. And I love what you're doing with your eyes. That's good. You are a mad butcher now.
It's an honor and a privilege to know I'm training the future of horror.
Up and stab and down again and up and stab. Good. Use the glutes. Close.
Well, every year we get a few of the traditional students. Your knife-wielding maniac, your historically themed undead, your crazy mask wearer, who I'm pretty sure is retarded.
I was murdered by my classmates at prom, rose from the undead, and now I'm driven to kill horny teens. You know, the usual.
They call me the Puritan, for that name be not trademarked.
The hands are a great gimmick, but they do make it hard to go to the bathroom.
Next, we're going to learn how to stay in the backseat of a car to decapitate the driver.
Exactly. I have a note. I get car sick.
Oh, you could do it in a parked car, like at a lover's lane or something.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Although lover's lane, that's a little antiquated, you know. I don't know if those things exist anymore.
I died in the 70s, so.
And they called it lover's lane?
No, they called it spot.
I know where that is.
All right, field trip.
These people are going to be scaring future generations. It's my responsibility to make them the best monsters that they can be.
Okay. What we have here are three events. Teens smoke pot. You kill teens. Teens have sex. Now, can anyone tell me the correct order these go in?
Ooh. You kill the teens, and then you have sex
No.
with
them. Yes.
Dogma!
Puritan.
You shall not smite the teens till after they have finished smoking consumption weed and laid in sinful Congress.
Correct. I think.
It's my responsibility to make sure these students are terrifying. And I think I do a pretty good job teaching them to use their weapons in the most frightening way possible.
Yeah. Okay, hey, okay. You can stop. Hey, you can stop. Okay, just go at it.
Had enough? Can't take any more high-quality, medium-budgeted comedy? Well, too bad, because there's more on the way. Right after this slick tease package.
Wait, stop! You can't break the fourth wall. You're ruining television, Casey.
No, you're ruining television!
Since the money isn't coming in, the comedy is going to keep going out. Tremble in fear.
Presenting the new 12-inch PowerBook, the world's most compact, full-featured notebook computer. And the new 17-inch PowerBook, the world's first and only 17-inch notebook computer. The new 12 and 17-inch PowerBooks. The next big and small things from Apple.
Why hasn't anybody come to free us yet?
I don't know. It's really kind of embarrassing. I mean, this is our show. I mean, I wonder, do we forget something? I mean, somebody's birthday? I don't know.
What's really embarrassing is I've only received $12.37 so far. Half of that is change from my car. Look, people, I'm not joking around here. That ransom isn't going to pay itself. My student loan officers know where I live. Until I start getting some substantial cash sent my way, I will continue to blast you with pure rays of blinding comedy, or a comedy-like substance, like this.
You're gathered here today.
You don't have anything else metal on you.
Oh, that's right. Here. I did the nail thing again. That was awesome. It's always awesome.
Excuse me. Hi, I'm Wonder Woman. You may know me from my comic books or my upcoming feature film. In fact, my work has inspired a lot of young women to explore careers in vigilante justice. But while fighting crime may seem exciting, it isn't always glamorous. Inside the secret warehouse. You have to be very careful. It's very dark in here. It's dangerous.
Why do you want to run? Ow!
Billy!
Ow! 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 My boot! Stop it!
My boot fell off!
Quit it! Ow! 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 I just had that worked on!
Ow! Your costume! Stupid! Ow! I hate your costume!
At least my costume has pants!
Don't stop.
Come on.
Oh, for crap's sake.
I mean, we're fighting crime here, people. Will you lock on the door?
This is ridiculous.
So before you decide to be a costume crime fighter, remember this. Sometimes being a superhero isn't so super. All right, how do I land this thing? This isn't the cockpit.
Now, according to my research...
You son of a bitch!
Oh, my God! Jim!
Oh!
Jimmy! Jimmy!
Oh, great!
Oh, my God!
Oh, that
Wait,
sucks.
Jimmy! Jimmy, what happened?
Oh, what the hell do you think just happened, babe? I just got shot in the gut, and now it looks like the geeker is a goner.
Don't worry, Jimmy. Hold on there. We've got people in the studio calling the paramedics right now. We're going to get you safe, Jimmy. I promise.
You know what? I'm not seeing the light and all that stuff.
Jimmy, hold. Jimmy, you got to hold on for me, man. You got to hold on.
Olivia, before I go, one last thing.
Yes, Jimmy, anything you need. I'm right here. What?
Will you show me your rack there, babe?
Okay, seriously, please just don't leave us here, okay?
No, and please, you know, just send in some money so we can go home.
Okay, seriously?
Just at least free me. Send it enough to get me out of here.
Still to come, the sad hilarity of actual information, courtesy of the feed. What? You can't laugh at life's little misfortunes? How about you send me in some money so we can end this charade?
The 11-year-old girl recently saved her family from a fiery death thanks to a video game. And not just any video game, Grand Theft Auto. See, the Pleak family were en route to a relative's house when their car skidded off the road and landed upside down. And young Audrey Pleak helped her parents and younger siblings to safety. Because thanks to an after-school regimen of rated M games, the plucky Miss Pleak knew that cars explode when they flip. Congratulations, Audrey. I hope you remember other important GTA life lessons. Shotguns are no good in a long-range firefight. And never, never meet a Russian for drinks without your Kevlar. And they say Liberty City is a town without pity. Till next time, I'm Morgan, and this has been A Minute.
Like it's time for the feed. Bring out Layla.
Haley, help!
Okay, listen, you gotta help us. We're like in some weird plot line thing.
It's really convoluted.
It really is. Can we just, my arms are free, but I can't help.
Thanks, guys. I'm Layla Cayley, and it's time to start the feed. If you're a fan of Sam Fisher, get ready for a new adventure later this year. Foreign gaming magazine Palaha has just released details for the newest game in the Splinter Cell series, Conviction. The combat in the game is said to be similar to the action in the Bourne films. The game is an Xbox 360 exclusive and should be out later in the fall. It seems that making a next-gen Grand Theft Auto isn't as easy as Rockstar Games expected. In an interview with PlayStation Magazine, creative VP Dan Houser stated that differences between the 360 and PS3's hardware are causing some challenges. Every Xbox owner does not have a hard drive, and there's not enough room for information on the discs. The PS3 has built-in hard drives and more storage on Blu-ray discs. However, there's longer loading times. Either way, there's a lot of work to do before October. The Virginia Tech massacre has put the nation on watch and gotten a student in hot water. In Fort Bend, Texas, a high school student was arrested over a map he created for the online shooter Counter-Strike, which copied the look of his school. Police raided the boy's house and confiscated a hammer, the only weapon they could find. No charges have been filed at this time, however, he was expelled and transferred to another school. It seems internet radio is here to stay, at least for another 60 days. The U.S. Copyright Royalty Board has extended the date that internet radio stations would have to pay retroactive royalties. The new deadline of July 15th will give the stations a little more time to make appeals. The government is trying to make the internet services pay 60 to 300% of their revenues in royalties, whilst traditional broadcasters pay zero. That's not fair, is it? Steve Jobs is getting back in touch with his counterculture roots. Under pressure from environmental groups, Jobs posted an announcement on the Apple website detailing their green initiatives and highlighting the work they've done so far. Apple also said they would step up their efforts in the future and keep consumers more informed about their programs. And finally, if you're friends with Senator Barack Obama on MySpace, now you're actually friends with the senator. The senator's page was set up and operated by a volunteer supporter named Joe Anthony and had gotten over 160,000 friends. This week, the senator's campaign wanted to officially take over the page, but wouldn't pay Anthony the $39,000 he asked for. MySpace sided with the senator, but reset his friend count and allowed Anthony to keep all the contacts he'd made since starting the page. On Anthony's MySpace blog, he said he felt bullied by the campaign and would no longer be voting for Obama. Oh, just get over it. Well, that's it for today, but don't worry, the feed doesn't stop here. Keep your iPod fed with all the news you need to know by downloading our Daily Feed podcast. Get it now at g4tv.com/podcast. I'm Layla Cayley, and you've just been fed. Back to you guys.
Why wouldn't she help us?
Because she's upholding the proud tradition of journalistic impartiality. Morally, she's not allowed to interfere.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And I have her doing the feed from a soundproof one-way mirror chamber. It helps keep her focused. Roll the tease!
So you're still there, eh? Fine. Time to bring out the big guns. Saviors, anthropologists, and slashers.
I don't care if I live or die. I'm looking for someone.
Don't do anything stupid, cousin.
Man, I'm right for you, Nicky. I'm right.
I don't want to die, man. Not like this.
How would you like to die?
We need to go bust somebody, man.
I'm the one who survived.
Grand Theft Auto 4, out now. Rated M for mature.
Big star.
Star Wars fan? Then you need to see the biggest Star Wars event ever. G4 presents Star Wars at 30, live Friday, May 25th.
Hello, I'm Office Jesus, and I'm here to talk to you about the plight of the American college-educated television writer. Everyone loves television, but not many know what goes into it. The American television writer is woefully underpaid and is often saddled with huge student loan debts from fly-by-night communication schools. As a result, they often can't afford the children's sugar cereals and hard liquor they need to bring you quality scripts. So donate, won't you? Okay, that's it. Can I get paid now?
Sure. Nope.
Oh, it looks like you forgot to sign this. Oh, sorry, it must have slipped my mind, you know.
There you go.
Thank you. Oh, wait a minute. Can I take that back? I gotta jot a memo down on it. I can write this off for taxes. Oh, sure, yes. I know how taxes can be.
There you go.
It looks like you didn't date it.
Oh, would you come on already? God, cut the
Fine. More comedy then.
My computer bag in my lap.
We're not going to put the baddest motherfucker on television in a Vespa.
Just saying it.
Listen up, people. We got a problem. Jack Bauer is in Burbank. We need to get him to LAX. And we need to get him there in 10 minutes.
What the hell?
That's not possible.
It needs to be done. And it needs to be done in exactly 45 seconds.
No!
Now.
Well, the obvious route would be the 101 to the 405.
At 4 o'clock, are you crazy? He only has 10 minutes.
He could use a fast motorcycle.
What?
Paul, it's Abby.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just ran a micro data encryption of all the future SIG alerts.
And?
It's right across the board. There's no way Jack Bauer could make it from Burbank to LAX in time.
Damn it!
He could use a fast motorcycle.
Oh, Laurel Canyon, that's a really pretty drive.
Damn it, it's not a sightseeing tour. For once, pull your head out of your ass.
Fast bike.
Wait. He's only 2 minutes from Burbank. He could go to Burbank International Airport, hijack a plane, commandeer it, and drive it to LAX.
Wait, what about the no-fly zone that he put over the city in case of a nerve gas attack?
No!
Jack has the antidote. He can inject himself in mid-flight. All right, everybody, what do you think? Flight? Antidote?
Sure.
Yeah. Sounds
good. Good, I think we got it.
Good.
Good work, people.
You know, he could use a fast.
Would you shut the up about the motorcycle?
Just saying.
And if these sexy migrant workers are denied their traditional source of work, these booth babes will be forced to turn to other means of employment. Begging, working the street, or even worse.
You know, you play them over and over again.
It's not the same.
Yes,
is it
better?
Oh, yeah.
It was
really impressive.
It was
a little
like,
I think I have to stop. There were some ice on some great Jimmy Choo shoes I want to get if I win. Unbelievable. Yeah, I can't. $300 is not that. Oh my god, what is that? Ew, that's disgusting. Oh god, look at that much hair in something. Ew. Oh god, who's that? Oh god. Oh my god, I'm gonna throw up, I think.
Oh my god, where?
I'm gonna be sick.
Can we sue?
Get the manager,
I think we
right
need
now.
To sue. They have plenty of money.
Isn't this a union town?
It's disgusting.
Oh, god.
I've never seen something so awful in my whole life.
Well, we're up to $26.50 right now. You'd better step it up, or those two aren't going to be going anywhere anytime soon. And, you know, I'll show you more comedy, which I know you don't want.
And it's really in your best interest to send in some cash. The human mind can't handle the amount of comedy I'm about to throw at you. Can't handle it!
What you want.
G4 is like being visited by a badass video game goddess who's way into anime and tight circuit-laced apparel. Plus, she has a knack for digging up funny, obscure videos, and she can quote word for word from classics, like Old School and The Big Lebowski.
That dude abides.
Like G4, she is obsessed with high-tech gadgetry, out there blogs, and opinionated podcasts. She will take you to the sorts of far-off worlds where Master Chief and Transformers rule the landscapes. This energy-clad goddess slash sensei of digital goodness is plugged into what's going on. And therefore, my man, so are you. G4 is like that. You know, basically.
No, it doesn't. I've been telling you that.
I mean, do you think that he knows?
Honestly, no, not at this point. I don't think he gets it.
Well, I mean, should we just tell him?
Casey!
What?
Dude, hey, nothing but love, but we don't really think the plan's going to work. Buddy.
No, no.
What are you talking about? Of course it's going to work. I planned it perfectly.
People like the comedy sketches, right?
Yeah.
No, most of them. Well, some. I'm comfortable with some.
So you really can't threaten people with something they like. I mean, that's not really how threatening works. Did you know that?
Yeah, I mean, did you, like, I didn't hear him. Did you set up like a phone line or like a PayPal account,
a website, or
some Gmail, something? Like, how were people supposed to actually get their money to you, Case? I thought they'd
just come drop it off.
Ooh.
Oh wow. Okay, so let me get this right. So besides buying the rope, clearly, and the chains to tie us up, you really didn't plan this out at all.
Nope.
Enough logic! Roll the tape!
Do not bury your Wiimote in the ground in an attempt to grow additional Wiimotes.
Talisker Fernley here, noted sociologist, anthropologist, and lover of all things science. Last year, I discovered a new species of man, a unique combination of geek and nerd. The gnerd lived only to feed, and fed only on E3 convention swag. Since that sensual discovery, my team of researchers here at the Talisker Fernley Institute have discovered a full Gnerdus family tree, with branches extending in every conceivable direction. But the deeper we dig, the more we are vexed by a single elusive species.
They exist mainly in their world, but their complex courtship and mating rituals can only take place in ours.
And I'm convinced this rare and beautiful display is about to take place for one of the most reclusive species known, Gnerdus Mammorpagus Fantasticus. The final Fantasian. Come with me to the anthropology van. Oh, oh God! It's okay. It's all right. It does this once in a while. There's a trick to it. It's okay. We'll go. Come on. Every year, these final Fantasians are said to meet in the same geographic location to spawn. Get out of the passing lane, you cow!
According to legend, this species gathers in the same hidden location each year to celebrate their love of the online role-playing game Final Fantasy XI. I could tell we were getting close.
Oh there, what's this? A Fantasian dropping here in the wild, extremely rare. Eureka! Eureka! Eureka!
Eureka, I had found it.
Come on already!
Behold, the final Fantasians. Look at them. Their magnificent garments clearly a reflection of their in-game persona. I knew the next step was to approach a small tribe at their primary activity area and find out more about this breed's parallel universe, the magical realm of Vanadiel.
How is everyone doing tonight? So you live in Vanadiel?
Yes.
But you're all here now.
I noticed two recurring themes that kept driving them back to their fantasy world. The shared sense of community and the ability to come exactly what one wished to be.
So you have rings that make you smarter?
Yeah.
So I've heard tale of these tantalizing feminine cat creatures. What are these things?
Mithra, yes.
So all of the Mithra are hot?
Just gorgeous.
Do you think they would marry a human anthropologist?
Yes.
Fantastic.
As if by divine providence, I managed to spot a small cabal of these Mithra huddled around a space heater. I approached cautiously in the name of science.
This is my Final Fantasy, I'll tell you that. Is the tail functional?
It's so I can hit people with it when they're bad.
Would you consider me to be exceptionally naughty?
As I continued my exploration, I stumbled upon my own personal portal into Vanadiel.
Sensual.
Haste on me!
Do you guys have healing potions? I really could use a buff, guys. I'm really slow here. I'll be done in a minute. I'm almost at level. Just leave me alone.
As the sun set, the Fantasians gathered for the final ceremony. And I realized as I joined them that being a Fantasian was more than just flashy costumes and pale skin. At first an outsider, after spending a few hours with this rare species, I felt like even I, Talisker Fernley, could join the dance.
In our world, I'm a respected anthropologist with the GED. But as a final Fantasian, I can be anything. A ninja, a monk, or my ultimate dream, a man with four fabulous cat wives.
Robot rape isn't about the physical, it's about power.
Look, when I first knew him, your father was already a great pilot. Well, I mean, he was eight. And he kind of drove this race car sort of thing. In fact, I wouldn't actually call him a pilot, per se. Although he did blow up a Federation command ship. Accidentally.
But you said Vader betrayed and murdered my father.
Did I? Did I? yes, that's why I always like to say it all depends on a certain point of view.
Certain point of view?
When your father was seduced by the dark side, he ceased to be Anakin Skywalker and became Darth Vader.
Wow. He must have been consumed by evil over a long period of time then.
Well, no, not really. Seriously, one minute he was all, "Hello, hello, everyone, old charm. What new adventure shall we have today?" Next, he's killing babies. Sorry, younglings.
Chop the shit out of me, I don't mind saying.
Oh, and Leia's your sister.
Leia's my sister.
Yes, I just said that. Leia's your sister.
Leia's my sister?
Yes, yeah. She'll try to give you some BS about having vague memories of your mother, but don't buy it. Mumsy kicked it when you're both minutes old. The only cuddling either of you got was from a medical droid.
How did my mother die?
The official diagnosis, I believe, was a broken heart.
Come again?
Yes. Broken heart.
You can die of that?
Apparently.
That's retarded.
You're telling me.
Do not offer your Wiimote as a burnt offering to your ancestors. The Nintendo Wii was designed to be played by the living.
I'm trying to find this convention center. I think I'm lost. No, I passed fake New York. I passed the plastic Eiffel Tower, too. Is that the green neon or the pink neon? Is it, no, I'm at Las Vegas and Flamingo. I'm right there. Got to be shitting me. John, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing it. So you could send somebody else to the convention. I honestly don't care.
Well, I guess I've got one more sketch to cripple you with laughter and destroy the Econom and whatever. Just go to commercial.
If you haven't been watching Attack of the Show...
So this really hasn't been going the way that I wanted it to go.
Why didn't I go to state school? Why?
You're watching G4. Next, an all-new Cinematech NE on Midnight Spec, followed by another Cinematech NE. Later, Star Trek TNG. G4, TV that's plugged in.
What you got there, hon?
Just a laser level I picked up at a surplus store.
What you got there, hon?
Just the laser level I learned about on Yahoo Answers.
Oh, you fixed my spine.
Get answers from people who know on Yahoo Answers.
Yahoo!
The
The people who craft, tool, stitch, and fit together the Mazda CX-7 crossover SUV have no interest in taking any shortcuts. As a result, neither do the people who drive it. Mazda CX-7. Designed and engineered the Zoom Zoom way.
There are times you gotta ask yourself, do you think you've got the torque, or do you know you've got the torque? Get Q Torque Power for trucks, heat activated to help more torque reach the road. No leading synthetic oil delivers more torque than Q Torque Power.
You okay?
Are you guys okay?
Yeah, well, yeah.
Are you okay? It's the first question you ask after an accident. And you want to hear back, yeah, I'm okay. The next question, will my insurance take care of this? Allstate can help you answer yes to that one. Here's how. With accident forgiveness from Allstate, your rates won't go up just because of an accident, even if it's your fault. And it starts the day you sign up. What if your new car is totaled in the crash? With new car replacement, if your new car is totaled in the first three model years, you can get a brand new car, not just the depreciated value.
Even the best driver can have an accident. If this happened to you, would you have the protection you need? Call Allstate Direct now at 866-895-0700 and ask about your choice auto. Only from Allstate.
Are you in good hands?
1985. Gretzky makes The Great One seem like an understatement. 1994. Messier backs up his mouth with his stick. 2001. Stanley Cup engraver finally has to learn how to spell Bork. 2006, Doug Waite separates shoulder, lifts cup with his heart. 2007, the NHL Stanley Cup playoffs on Versus. Do or die.
Tomorrow on Attack of the Show. The summer is heating up, and so is the box office. That's why we're giving you a sneak peek at hits like Transformers, as well as sleepers, like 28 Weeks Later. It's Attack of the Show, tomorrow at 7 and 11 p.m. Eastern.
Ridiculous. This is ridiculous.
Well, you've won. I give up. I've got just under $30, and I'm going to go buy some Quick Picks, because, sad as it is, that is the most realistic way of paying for a decent communication school these days. So here's the last sketch, because I already went through the trouble of getting it ready. See you around. Begging on the street, probably.
Okay, class, today we're gonna learn how to properly chase a victim through the woods. Any volunteers to play the victim?
They always pick me as the victim, because I'm the only girl.
Carrie, excellent, thank you, come on. Come on.
And you're gonna run that way, and I want you to run fast, okay?
Please don't touch me.
Okay, class, so Carrie's gonna run as the victim. Big fella, you're gonna chase her. All right, ready? Go! No. No, 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 no. No. You don't run after the victim. You walk with purpose. You're trying to scare her, and you certainly don't run like this, all right? All right, take it back to one. Crazy eyes, you're in. All right, ready? Walk with purpose, and go! Carrie. I'm gonna need you to fall down more.
You want me to fall down?
Yeah, you need to fall down more. That way, they can catch you.
Okay.
Go!
Oh, I'm falling down.
Fall down.
Oh, I'm falling down. Oh, no, I fell down.
That's good. Crazy Eyes, you can probably walk a little faster.
Why don't you put this on? There you go. Yeah.
What the hell is this thing?
Rocks. Put your shoulders back. You're a pretty girl. Act like one. All right, I really need somebody to catch her.
So you're the man. You ready to go?
Have you seen the size of my feet?
Ready? Third time.
Fine.
Go. Can somebody stop her, catch her.
Was a goodly shot.
Yeah, yeah, that'll do.
God.
That'll do.
Ow. Ow.
Is she dead?
Don't worry about it. She's undead. I'm sure she'll be fine.
Do one more.
No, I'm not saying that you want to. I'm just saying I don't want to. I'm not speaking for you. You tell me not to speak for you all the time.
All I'm saying is you left me out. Like,
wait. Hold on.
You gotta be kidding me.
Wait.
Are you serious?
They just come right up. Wow. Casey really sucks at this.
Coming up on the next Attack of the Show, we bring you our summer movie special. Spider-Man 3, Pirates of the Caribbean, Transformers, The Simpsons, Hostel 2. We'll tackle them all. We'll have our favorite film and filmmaker blogs and blog watch, plus some of the best and worst movie-based games and Game Break. And in a loop, we'll attempt to pick the best movie or movies of the summer. That's all in the next Attack of the Show. Now I'm gonna go cash some paychecks.